So today I want to talk about unity in the Godhead. Because we just returned from the Feast of Tabernacles, and if you look between the lines, you know, the feast is all about unity. It will be a unified environment during the millennial reign of Jesus Christ, because his spirit will be, his spirit, the knowledge of God, it says, will be as the waters cover the sea. You know, you try to understand the thoughts of God, and you could become an atheist or an agnostic. You try to understand how God thinks. And we can use the examples that we just mentioned a while ago about the Feast of Tabernacles. All of us are at the feast enjoying, having a good time. And the next thing you hear, somebody has to go to the hospital. So, you know, you try to understand these things. And for some people, it doesn't make sense. Just as how you try to understand how we came into existence, this great, awesome God who controls the universe, who is in charge of the universe, who establishes all these intricate laws, and it's everything is in order. And you try to find out, or you're trying to determine how he came to exist. Did he have a time when he didn't exist, and so on? And I tell you, you'll get a headache for that, for trying to do that. You try to understand how God allows babies to die and in plane crashes, and, you know, just coming in on the plane last night, you know, you hear the echoes of children around you. And it dawned on me, say, wow. If this plane were to go down, and thank God it didn't, those cries would be silenced. Those children wouldn't have an opportunity at life. How could God allow that? And these things happen, mind you. Didn't happen last night, but it happened over and over again over the years. Not only in plane crashes, but through simple things like accidents and so on. Diseases. Parents killing them. Their own children. But how God allows these things to happen? So, you know, you come back from the Feast of Tabernacles now, all pumped up and ready, I would imagine. And I know these thoughts are going to come across your mind sometimes. But if we weren't serious about our beliefs in God, if we weren't that dedicated to what we believe in and committed to what we believe in, at some point in our lives, some of us would want to confront these questions, and we would want the answers, and if we don't get them, sadly, we may walk away from the faith. Nevertheless, to us, God should not be a puzzle. To us, God should not be a puzzle. Because once you have that relationship with him, and you know who he is, first of all, you know who he is and what he stands for. There are some things that the human mind just cannot comprehend. We are limited. Think of a time when there was nothing. You can't. You just can't. So some things we leave for when God's kingdom is established, as we just celebrated at the Feast of Tabernacles. And we will understand. We will understand those things. But since the dawn of civilization, mankind has been plagued by all manner of, you know, shortcomings or challenges in their lives that have forced them to seek answers for which, or to ask questions for which human reasoning cannot solve. We've been plagued with violence, we've been plagued with war, with murders, and peace has become an elusive dream. There's no peace on the land. In fact, the word of God says, there will be no peace, or the way to peace, they know not. And so you hear every day about these wars or rumors of wars going on. It will be like that, right on to the end of the age. And much of this has been caused by divisions and the lust for power. Power. One of the interesting facets of God and how he works. It's how he works with in complete unity with his Son. It's unbelievable. And that is why some people get confused about Trinitarian things and so on. Or who is greater than who and all of that. But the Godhead is take a study of that. And it is so, well, Jesus Christ himself said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. It may sound like a simple statement, but there's a lot in that. In John 1:3, we read, all things were made through him. And by the way, what I'm doing here today is the beginning of a series of thematic presentations that we're going to have here for the rest of the year, talking about unity in the Godhead. It doesn't make sense, and I repeat, it does not make sense that God is united and his people, even at a congregational level, there's disunity. It's the opposite of what God is. It doesn't mean you can't have opinions. It doesn't mean that that person can't have opinions. But there has to be an understanding at a level that it brings peace to the congregation. So over the next few weeks, you'll hear along that line, I'm starting with unity at the Godhead. Then we'll have unity at the church, unity at the individual level, unity at the collective level, and so on. Because I think it's important, just returning from the Feast of Tabernacles, that we have this understanding. Because look, a whole year is ahead of us. We don't know what lies ahead of us. There could be some serious challenges for all of us as a church and as individuals. One of the things sticking out in my head from the Jamaican experience is the struggle that people have to go through there. You see it in the church and you see it outside the church. But the resolve is, the resolve is that God has to be our priority. That's the resolve. God has to be our priority. So no matter what's happening out there, we have to put God at the top. And if we believe in the unity that he stands for, then we would have to put away some of our prejudices or some of our disagreements to come to a level to make sure that the church, the congregation, runs as smooth as possible in the interest of God, not in our own interest. So it tells us in John 1:3 that all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The word became flesh and tabernacled among us, and we have seen his glory and glory of the Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So Jesus Christ is God. Some say he's not. But then they don't understand how could Jesus... Well, their interpretation is there more than one God. No, God is a family. Just like how you have the human family. Brother Courtney and Bridget and the daughter. A family. So we have God the Father, Jesus the Son. Jesus is going to marry the church. We are the children. I don't know why churches can't see that so clearly. But you look at Colossians 1:16, it says, for by him, Jesus, meaning Jesus, all things were created in heaven and earth, visible and invisible. And some people would wonder, why God the Father allowed Jesus to do this? Because he's God, wouldn't he want to take the credit for doing all of these wonderful works? But he commanded the Son didn't back away. He said he did as he was commanded. That shows complete unity and understanding between them of the roles they play, because they have roles. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. But Jesus is going to inherit all things. That's what we are told in the Word of God. Jesus Christ will inherit everything. The Father is giving up that. Those are some thoughts that run in our head. But you have to understand they operate as one. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God. It's one God. Verse 17 says, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Everything comes together. So what we see here unfolding is that the Godhead is so united that the Father asks his Son to do all the creation, and he did it accordingly as he has been commanded and to his expectations. Because we don't see one word in the scriptures that tells us that the Father was displeased with anything that Jesus did. In fact, when he was on earth, he said, behold my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Complete unity. This is their nature. Their nature is one of complete agreement. So when we start to paint God as some confused God, or we have teachings that confuse one, and that is not of God. Could never be. And the word tells us too that he's not the author of confusion. Adam and Eve were created and they enjoyed fellowship with God and each other. They were the first human beings. They were complete. They were created in a unified state. Remember? The rib. The flesh. Two flesh came together as one. Just like with a married couple. Come together as one. So you see this complete unified state of existence in anything that God does. The world will be at one with God. We're told that at one meant. When the kingdom of God is established on earth, there's no opposition. Can never be. It's at one. Everything is at one. In our relationship with God, we have to be at one with him too. That's why a double-minded person is unstable in all his ways. You can't have one foot in the world and one in the church. It has to be at one with God. Complete unity. Adam was responsible for the upkeep of the Garden of Eden. Eve was the helper. They did that together as the first human beings. Until things turned out differently. And so we see the effects today. You think if all nations were in complete unity, we would have wars? No. If you think a husband and a wife were in complete unity, we would have divorces? No. Anything that God touches in his day, I'm not talking at the human level, but at the godly level, at the divine level, it's united. He unites rather. But whatever Satan the devil touches, he divides. And that is why one of the seven deadly sins, and I don't know if many of us here are aware of that, is divisions. And God says he despises it. He hates it. So we as individuals in the church, we have a role to strive, patterning off the Godhead, for a unified church. Surely the church of God today is not united. They have all kind of different things happening. But it's his desire that it should be. We don't know if that will happen before he returns. But that is a desire. Because he stands for unity and will always, because God cannot change. He's always the same. So Satan the devil disrupted creation, and since that he has been trying to interrupt everything that concerns God. From marriage to God's plan for Israel, for God's plan for his people, for the church, and his plan for you. His plan for you. So he continues to hatch plans for us. You know that. So I say to you, you have to continue to hatch plan for him. Don't back off. Whatever he does, you counteract it. That's why I say put on a breastplate of righteousness. Resist him and he will flee from us. Satan's only interest is to divide. Satan's only interest is to divide. As one of the leaders in the church, I'm always conscious of people who walk into this congregation with a motive. I would advise you to do the same. You can talk to people and know what they're about. Easily, you can know what they're about. So if someone comes in here, wants to draw away people to go to their own little home group or whatever, I had to tell one day that they don't come back. I don't want that here. Because God doesn't want that. In fact, I said to the person, there is a wide world out there waiting to hear the message. Go to them. Why are you coming here? To people who are converted already. I said, go to them. I said, I wish you all the best. Because here are converted people. Why would you want to come to, you know, encourage people to come to your little group to hear what you have to say when they are getting messages here already? It doesn't make sense. I said, go out on the street with the gospel. I'll pray for you if you do that. So when we are in an organization, and as I said, for me, someone comes in here and I try to talk to them, and I hear a different motive, I'm turned off. The harvest is plentiful. So you go out there and you reap your harvest. People who are coming and supporting the work, leave them alone. And I mean, it's up to them if they want to go. But why waste time come here when you have the whole harvest out there? So I always concern about that, because God says he hates divisions in the body. So we have to have unity at the top of the agenda. Where there is disunity, there is Satan the devil. That's what the word says. Wherever there is disunity, he's present. He's present. So having just returned from the feast, you know, it's a kind of new year for us in that regard, because we look forward to the next year coming up. This is something to bear in mind as we go along. And you look at Israel's journey to the wilderness, to the time of Jesus Christ, when he came on earth to do this mission. He sent the Comforter to put fire on the church at Pentecost. So we see how God has that desire for us to prepare for him. The Godhead functions, as I said earlier, in complete unity, because the Son is going to marry the church. Will Jesus Christ wants to come to marry a divided church? The church of God is divided in some instances, yes. We don't know what will happen before that. But I can tell you, if the church belongs to God, it has to be united. It has to be united. It should not be divided. Because I don't think he's coming to marry a divided church. At somehow it will. I'm hoping there has to be some change. But if we can get it at the congregational level, at least from that perspective, as we prepare. But you know, the reality is too, we have to realize that Jesus Christ is not coming to save an organization. Jesus Christ is not coming to save a church organization. Jesus Christ is coming to save individuals. Individuals, for sure. But if that individual is culcating disunity, I don't know how Christ is going to save him. Jesus Christ has been building his church from day one on the foundation of unity, because that is what he stands for. We see how he does that in Matthew 16:15. How he activated the church, so to speak. And we can turn there. Matthew 16, verse 15 to 18. He He said unto them, But whom say you that I am? And Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. So we see an element of unity right here. The two of them have that understanding. My Father which is in heaven. And I say unto you that thou art Peter, Petros, in Greek, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of the grave shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, whatsoever you shall bind on earth, etc. So he's going to build his church regardless. Regardless of the distractions, he's going to build that church. So we just have to be a part to make sure we are a part of that church. He reveals to each believer that Jesus Christ activated the church through his death, through his burial, through his resurrection. And then he gave power and authority to his followers to go tell the good news to all the world, as we read in Matthew 28:18. Go into all the world, preach the gospel, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and so on. So Jesus is the head of the church, as we are told in Colossians 1:18. A body he doesn't want to see divided. In fact, the Bible, we know, over and over, complete Paul, in his writings, in his epistles, in his letters, there's always a message of unity. You read the Corinthian letters, there was a problem there with unity. Chapter 1, said he heard of divisions among you. Had to write back quickly, correct that, set that straight. We can't go along. The Bible is not silent when it comes to unity in the Godhead and in the church as well. God hates those that seek to cause division and strife. There's a double warning in Proverbs 6:14 from God to those that seek to cause divisions by their malicious gossip and opinions, because that tongue, that little member called the tongue, is a mischief maker and can create a lot of strife. Those that soweth discord among the brethren, God hates that. Psalm 133 tells us, the Lord blesses those who dwell together in unity. 133:1. Those who dwell together in unity. But those for their own selfish ambitions will be severely dealt with by the Lord. We know the story in Numbers 16:1-3 about the sons, about Korah and his wicked companions who sought to cause the people to rebel against Moses and Aaron. They were spreading what? Disunity. Discord. And it catches on like a virus. You know, you have a bad cold and it spreads throughout the congregation. That is how it get caught on. So as believers and members of one body, reminding ourselves that the God who we worship, we adore, we go to the feast to give homage to him, the one who we come together at the Lord's Passover to renew our agreement or covenant with him, the one who shows us how to celebrate, or not celebrate, but to take ourselves out of the sinful world during the days of unleavened bread, how to put sin out of our lives. The same one who reminds us through the Feast of Pentecost of the day of his resurrection, and that we are destined to become first fruits of this harvest. That same one wants us to be reminded of the unity he has with his Father. Remember, after his resurrection, one of his first acts was to pray to the Father for the glory he had with him before the world was, that kind of relationship. He warns in Romans 16, verse 17, about those who would sow discord among the brethren, that they will be destroyed. Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. In 1 Corinthians 1:10, Paul says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you speak the same thing and there be no divisions among you." What was happening in Corinth? Corinth was a metropolis. It was one of those really attractive cities. He had a kind of, you know, the Olympic Games. They didn't call it Olympics. I forget what they call it now. They had all the commerce and the trade. Greece was not far off. So they had all of that, wealth spilling over. So it was up. He had the pagan religions around. He had the temple worship system going on. But in Corinth, remember now, Corinth was a true church of God. They were the church of God, and it was true. Their teachings and so on were based on the scriptures. But what you had happening at Corinth is that these people were going, and members were going around dibby-dibby, you know that term? Dipping into every little thing they hear. In other words, they had itching ears. And they were bringing it back right into the congregation. Right into the congregation. You study the epistles. Paul got word from the congregation that these things were happening. There were some internal problems as well. So that's why he wrote chapters 12, 13, 14 about the gifts, because people were coming in and they were bringing these strange teachings, and there was a conflict. It causes division among the people there. So he had to write to them and say, "Listen, I heard that there be divisions among you. But his desire is that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." So one mind, one voice. Why is this important for a unified church to the Godhead? Again, the answer is simple. It's about unity and what the Father and the Son stands for. Because there's no dissension, there's no division, there's no disagreement, there's no disunity, there's no opposition, there's no quarrel in the Godhead, because God is one. In Colossians 2:9, Paul says, talking about the Godhead, he says, "It dwelleth all fullness of the Godhead bodily." The fullness, the full effectiveness of what God is, who he is, what he stands for, and what he will be doing in the future. They speak as one. Notice you don't see anything in the scripture, that any verse or phrase in the scripture that says one thing and then the Father comes and corrects him and says, "No, that's not so, my son." It's all in one. "Hear, O Israel," Moses proclaimed, "the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might." With all thy might. So the unity and oneness is a perfect pattern for all those who seek salvation, for salvation consists in being one with the Lord or God. And so Jesus prayed himself, John 17:21, for all true believers. He says, "That they may be one, as thou, the Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they may also be one in us." This is Jesus praying for believers, all of us, that we be at one as he is at one with the Father. So So when we want to get a glimpse of truly what the Godhead stands for, look at you, read through John 17 when you have some time, because it is so clear of what they stand for. John 17. These words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, thou always come, glorify thy Son, that thy Son may also be glorified in thee. The Father didn't spurn on him or said, you know, no, I can't. If thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And then he speaks of, you know, this glory, this unity he had with him. I have manifested thy name unto men which thou givest me out of the world, that thine were, thine they were, and thou gavest me, that they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. Are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. John 14, verse 1. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in me? You believe in God? You also believe in me. A unified God. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And, you know, he goes on to talk about, you know where I'm going and so on. But in verse 6, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Look at this again. You see the complete unity here. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Complete unity here. If you had known me, you have known my Father also. You know, you have some people who talks about you have to worship the Father, and some people have said this, that you put too much emphasis on Jesus and so on. If you have that understanding of the Godhead, you realize, and the Word of God says, Jesus Christ is the intercessor, the mediator between God and man. So that's why when we pray here, at the end of the prayer, we says in Jesus' name, because Jesus is the intercessor, the mediator between us and the Father. So whatever we put to Jesus, he takes it to the Father. How do you explain that? He says, if you have known me, you have known my Father. Also from henceforth, you know him and have seen him. But they weren't seeing the Father, they were seeing Jesus. But he said, yes, once you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So there's such a complete, it's mind-boggling when you see this complete unity of which he speaks here. Yes, we start out saying eternal Father in our prayers. But at the end, we says in Jesus' name. Because they are one. Nothing Philip didn't understand. He said in verse 9, have I been so long time with you and you have not known me, Philip? He that has seen me has seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, show us thy Father? So Philip was even asking the same question. I want to see the Father. Now Jesus said, seen me, seen the Father. Complete unity. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwells in me. He does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father. It is this unity is so complete in the Godhead, it's hard for some people to see even the difference. And how much time was he said? Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Truly, truly, I say unto you, he that believes on me, the works that I should do, he do also. And greater works than these he shall do, because I go unto my Father. Whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, and the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Etc. If you love me, keep my commandments, and so on. John 10. John has a lot to say about this unity that exists. Truly, truly, I say unto you, he that enters not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbs some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he that enters in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter opens, the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and lead them out. And when he puts forth his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, and they know his voice. So we are the sheep here. When we come before this throne of grace each Saturday and we pray for people, we pray for one another, we pray for sick, it doesn't stop at Jesus' feet. It goes straight to the Father. Straight to the Father. Because he says in verse 10, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they may have life. That they may have life. There are a lot of scriptures I want to give you. I probably won't have time to go through all of them to show you the complete unity that exists in the Godhead. But I just want to keep reminding us that if we are not a united body, speaking generally, if we are not a united congregation at the congregational level, brethren, what lies ahead for us as members of the body is going to be, it will have effects on our own spiritual walk with God. You better believe it. You won't see it now. It will have that kind of effect. So when someone walks in here, and it, look, We as a church don't pretend to be perfect. That there are problems, because I've had people here, I've had visitors who have come in here, and we can talk frankly today because we don't really have any visitors here. I won't regard Brother Sydney as a visitor. Sydney has come here all the time, right? But I've had people who have walked in here, visitors for the very first time. And our members, I don't know who, if they're still here or they're gone, are washing our dirty laundry in public, telling them all kind of negative things. And the person come back, more than one occasion, the person would come and say to me, what kind of church do you have? That I come here the first time, and your members are telling me about that person, how that person, whether they put all their money in jewelry or in hairstyle or makeup. It has happened. And what can I say? You tell me exactly what can I tell that person. Some years ago, I made a comment here about a person or persons who told me that they won't come here because all of us are hypocrites. And my advice to the person was, you come, but don't be a hypocrite. Or you be the exception. So you come and join us, but you come and set the example, and you don't be the hypocrite. The person back down, I don't see them, they haven't returned. But brethren, I'm telling you this, it has happened all the time. People come here for the first time and we greet them with all the negative things about the church. We should not. That is not in the interest of unity in the congregation. That is not in the interest of unity of the Godhead where we worship. So we should let them know that, look, this is the body of Christ. We are not perfect people. All of us are sinners, fallen short of the glory of God. Amen. And we live at the mercy of Jesus Christ. Amen. If it wasn't for that mercy, all of us would be doomed. So let's be positive. Let's be that ambassadors. On the other hand, I've had visitors who have come here and said, boy, you have some stalwarts here in the faith. I've met people for so many years, and what they're telling me just inspires me. So we have those people too. So let all of us strive for that. Not the first experience, the one that I just mentioned. That when they come in here, they want to come back. That's what unity does. Because if you're in a congregation, it's precious to you. This is where you come every week for your little food, spiritual food. Protect it. It's not my church. It's all of us. And you know what? It's God's church. It's for all of us. But I just want to tell you this, that some people have been turned off. Even that little food that we serve in the gym. You know that? Even that little snack that we serve in the gym. People will notice. People will come and say, boy, I don't know. It's like the food more important than anything else. Because I come down there and I sit alone and nobody come and say hi to me. And everybody talking with their food and enjoying their fellowship. It happens too. It happens too. So let's keep that in mind as we talk about unity here moving forward. So we see, you can make a note of these scriptures, I won't have time, how the Father and the Son are united in work. John 4:34, note that. In work, in the work that they do. Similarly, the work that we do, we should have that united effort. John 16:13-15, they are united in the work that they do. In creation, same thing. Ephesians 3:9. Genesis 1:2. Job 26:13-14. In authority, again, complete unity. Revelation 2:1, as well as verse 7. Hebrews 1:1-4. In love. And don't talk about, boy, this one take a whole sermon. How the Father and the Son are completely united in love. Because, as I said repeatedly, one of the definitions of God is love. So they are completely united. And as brothers and sisters, we should be there too. Complete unity in how we love one another. Witnessing, as a witness for Jesus Christ. They stand as the sovereign God, a witness to all humanity of who they are and that they are the only hope for humanity. And regardless that 7 billion people on earth, how many are so-called nominal Christians? It's like a million. But yet, he created 7 billion of them. See so much witnessing we have to do? They're united in being a witness as the only true God. John 8:18, John 6:8-14. In doctrine, they speak out of one mouth. I'm not saying some of us may not have doctrinal differences, but do not come and argue, and the visitor sees and it turns him off. There is a forum for that. The church has a forum for that. If you believe we have a wrong doctrine, come to me and I'll show you how you get it to the ears of a ministerial council, which determines doctrine. It doesn't make sense to come in and argue and other people walk in and say, well, this is a market house or something, and you don't see them come back. Whose interest does that serve? Whose interest does that serve? And I won't even go into that one because there have been many stories over the years with that one, or people just get turned off with that. Doctrine, John 7:16, John 14:26, John 16:15. In judgment, or when I say judgment, in how they, what God really stands for in terms of our expectations, John 5:22, verse 30, as well as John 16:11. So the Father sent the Son in complete unity, because that is their nature, to work the works of him that sent him. John 5:30, John 36:37, John 6:38, John 9:4, and so on. But it is a reflection of this unity that we see within their ambit. We see that in a diversity of functions, in the process of redemption. That's what God is all about, redemption. The Father was the planner. Ephesians 1:8. The Father was the planner. Ephesians 1:8 8 to 11. 2 Timothy 1:9. How we had this master plan, the two of them, so that we could see in Genesis when he says, let us together. Let us do this. Let us make man in our own image. Let us confound the language of the people down in Babel because they're getting out of hand. Let us. So they had this plan. But guess what? One of them had to be the sacrifice. Because the blood of bull and goats wasn't enough to sacrifice for our sinful lives. One of them. Who decides that? So you go back to the human family. In the home, there's a understanding of the relationship there. We know in the scriptures that the man is the head of the home. So in this sense, we have a father and we have a figure son. So the father said to the son, son, I love you so much, but I love the world too, my creation. So I'll have to send you. He's speaking with authority now as the father. I have to send you to die, to make that sacrifice, that all my sons and daughters will have an opportunity to escape eternal death. Nowadays, young people, when they talk to their parents and the parents tell them to do something, they curse the parents. Probably some of them want to beat the parents too, and some of them will kill the parents. I just read a quote here when I spoke at the feast in Jamaica, where this 18-year-old killed his parents because the parents wouldn't allow him to bring a dog into the home. So as simple as that. But what did Jesus do? Did he say, Father, no, I can't do that, Father, I'm God. To give up God's life, to go to stoop down to the level of a human being to die? No. There was no evidence of that. He did as he was commanded and became the sacrifice. John 4:34, Ephesians 1:3-7, 2 Timothy 1:10, 1 Peter 1:18-20. So we see all of that, how they function as unity. The Passover message is so clear in that. 1 Corinthians 10:16, the bread which we break, it is not the communion of the body of Christ, Paul asked. So are we to be subject to Christ, the head of the church, by the same means? We shall all make that pledge through baptism, recognizing his shed blood based on our commitment to live by the bread of life. Jesus Christ, to obey him just as how he obeyed the Father. I know time is running out, so I just want to rush through some things here. So unity will be achieved when we have the same mind. And as followers, as Christians, we should have the mind of God. And when we have the mind of God, that is where we can understand clearer what they stand for, that they are in complete unity. We all drink from the one cup of the Lord, verse 21 tells us, and partake of the table of the Lord. So if the Father and the Son, consisting of the Godhead, are so united, what is the message for the church? And it goes back to what Paul tells a divided church, as I read earlier in chapter 1, verse 10 of 1 Corinthians. Brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, I urge all of you to be in one agreement, not to have divisions among you, so you may be perfectly united in your understanding and your opinions. So we see from that time how God started the family. How should we then pattern our actions in the church, as he advises in Ephesians 4:1? So he says, walk worthy of the calling which we have been called, and with all lowliness and gentleness and longsuffering, bearing one another in love. And verse 3 says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So, as I close, how can we have unity in the church as we have in the Godhead? So we know Paul gives us a little of this in 1 Corinthians 14 and so on. Chapter 1, in fact, you can read chapter 1 right up to 14 in your study time. In 14 he says, in verse 26, when you come together, let all things be for edification. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. Verse 33. Let all things be done decently and in order. Verse 40. Ours is not a perfect system, but it has a design where many people can participate. Our next speaker on this subject will take up from here when they look closely at unity at the church level. That may be, that being coming, I'm not sure if it's next week or anyway, I think it's next week. And so you'll hear more about this theme of unity as we go along. But brethren, I just want to urge all of us, this is very important to God. I'm taking the blood off my shoulder now and letting you know. Right? That's basically what you hear from the pulpit is supposed to be doing, admonishing all of us. And I think it's a good time after the Feast of Tabernacles to really reflect on this as we go into another year filled with challenges. But we have to be united as a body, as a congregation, to face those challenges that lie ahead. May God bless you. So,